I'm holding on to a lady reindeer. I'm keeping her steady while Shart's kind of poking her out. And remember, these reindeer can fly, so when she bucks, I'm getting 20, 30 feet off the ground, and I'm still rocking zero pants here, so my hog taker and log maker are on full display.
I'm Agent Morris with the NSA, and this is Special Agent Kirkpatrick. Now, we know you've all been through quite an ordeal, so we appreciate you making the trip to Washington on such short notice.
Yes, you three experienced the first verified case of alien abduction, so naturally you are of great interest to the United States government.
It's nuts, man. I mean, we're just small-town buds who saw a UFO in the woods. I mean, now we're hanging out with the government.
Okay. Now, after the blue light pulled you into the spacecraft, what is your next memory?
I came to and saw a beautiful being made of, like, a beautiful calming light.
Yeah, same here. That being touched my head, and I felt every emotion in its purest form. It was amazing, and I cried, sir.
Okay, and you, Miss Rafferty?
Wow. What floor were you guys on? I woke up in a dirty metal dome, and 40 little gray aliens watched me pee in a steel bowl. And they took the bowl, walked out.
Interesting. Were these beings also bathed in light?
No. They were gray with big fat eyes, little mouths. They just stared while I peed. I don't think I was dealing with the top brass.
And how did they instruct you to urinate? Was that telepathically?
No. I woke up, I had to pee like a camel. So I started peeing, and one of the gray aliens slapped the wall and pointed at the bowl. So I got the hint, I kind of ducked, walked over the bowl, peed in.
Yes, I see. Now, when you all awoke, were you clothed?
I was wrapped in like a robe made out of warm, glowing energy.
Yeah, like a blanket made out of pure love.
Yeah, a little different for me. I had my shirt I came in with, but my pants were gone. So my coot was out. It was full Porky Pig in it in a drafty dome.
Now, did you all stay on the same ship the entire time, or?
Well, you know, my body did. But my consciousness was showing what lies beyond time and space. It was so beautiful. I'm sorry, I'm just crying about, just thinking about it a little bit.
Do you need a tissue?
What, no, sorry, I'll use my shirt.
The alien showed my mind the furnace of all creation, what we would call God.
What? These fancy cats are seeing God. Meanwhile, I'm starting phase two, which is me sitting on a stool while 40 gray aliens take turns gently batting my knockers around. Did y'all get the knocker stuff?
No knocker stuff, sorry.
And did you feel threatened, Miss Rafferty?
No. They were real respectful about it. They were in a line. And then one by one, they'd step up, slap a knocker, and then go to the end of the line, wait for another turn. It didn't hurt. It was like, I'm sorry, pardon me, Sharon. It's kind of like that. No harm, no foul.
It hurts. Look, it hurts.
Perhaps they were collecting biological data?
No. No, that felt super off the books. I swear to God, there was one gray alien by a door just kind of peeking. I think he was the lookout. Look, it wasn't my worst Wednesday night.
And how did the aliens return you all to Earth?
I was carried down gently. He's crying. Was carried down gently in a cradle of light placed into a soft bed of wildflowers.
Yeah. The light laid me down like a baby in a meadow near my house. I was smiling and weeping, tears of joy, sir.
All right, well, now this missed me a little bit. Because my grand exit was out of what was basically like a big airplane toilet, okay? parachute. I dropped down 7 feet onto the roof of a Long John Silver's. They threw out my pants separately. They missed the roof. My slacks landed in a frickin' pine tree 30 feet away. So I had to just chill up there with my damn coot coot and prune shoe hanging out till the place opened up.
Man, you got screwed.
Oh, you think, Todd?
Well, we'd like to take you guys for physical examinations now.
Yeah, all right. They're gonna be in knocker stuff?
Possibly. I'm sorry.
No, no, don't be. Just be gentle, because they're pretty banged up. Tell me about God. What's God's deal?
I'm Dr. Rhodes, and this is Dr. Christensen. Now, we know you've been through a lot this past week, and we appreciate you being here.
Yes, the fact that you three were all technically dead for 55 minutes makes your near-death experience of great interest to the scientific community.
This is nuts, man. I mean, we were just gal pals on a road trip who took a wrong turn into a lake, and, like, now we're medical miracles.
Indeed. Now, after your car became submerged and you lost consciousness, what was your first lucid memory?
My soul was gently lifted out of my body by, like, a beautiful glowing being, and it said, "I am your guardian angel. You are safe with me." And then we just floated up out of the car into the sky.
Same here. My angel said, "Take my hand, dear child." We floated up pretty high, but I wasn't scared. I felt, like, infused with this warm, loving energy.
Okay. And you, Miss Rafferty?
Yeah, similar concept, different execution. My angel said, "I'm Keith, hold on." And then he violently yanked my soul up out of my body by the waistband of my sweatpants.
And did you also feel a loving energy?
No. What I mostly felt was the pinching of an epic lady wedge. Because I was being frickin' airlifted by the crotch of my sweatpants, and it was jacked up into my cuckoo.
I see. And this all occurred while you were floating?
Yeah, I wouldn't call it a float. Keith would ratchet us into the air in quick 5-foot spurts followed by sudden stops. I don't think I was rolling with the employee of the month.
I see. Now, after you left your bodies, what happened next?
I was in a tunnel, and at the end was a bright glow, like, beckoning me forward. I drifted to the light with my angel. I don't know, it felt like I was going, like, home.
Yeah, I mean, it sounds corny, but the closer I got to the light, the more my heart filled with love.
What? These two Cinderellas are going to the ball. We will cut to my tunnel, which is a 6-mile-long steep slope that Keith made me run down in flip-flops. And now, mind you, my sweats were so stretched out they kept falling off, so I just had to kick them off. And now I'm full Donald Duckin' it. And I'm hoping down a 45-degree decline with my fun bun and mud gun hanging out, plain view.
Now, what occurred when you all reached the end of this tunnel?
In the light, I saw my mama. She said, "I'm always with you, baby." I hugged her and just never wanted to let go.
I saw my granddaddy. He took my hand. He didn't say anything. He just smiled and happy cried. Words can't describe how amazing it was.
Well, again, I stray from the pack here, so I get into my light, and out come thousands of dogs. All sizes, all breeds, just dogs just running around playing and yapping and nipping at each other. And I'm sporting no pants, remember? So I'm fighting off a gaggle of cold snouts, trying to sniff my drainer and my stainer. Look, at least somebody's interested, right?
And now, do dogs have a special significance in your life?
No. I think Keith botched it, sent me to dog heaven. By this point, it was pretty clear Keith was learning on the job.
Do any of you remember the moment that you essentially came back to life?
Yeah, my angel said to me,
"It is not your time," and then cradled me like a baby, took me back down and gently placed my soul back into my body.
Yeah, yeah, it felt like being tucked into bed by your mama.
Okay, now I am actually a little ticked off. My angel jammed my soul into my body like it was shoving a carry-on into a crowded overhead bin. I was like, "Keith, bud, maybe come up with a different game plan here." And he was like, "No, no, I can make it fit." And then he was using his elbows and jamming on my soul.
Now, why do you think it was so difficult?
All right, well, my theory is this. Keith accidentally grabbed one of the dead dog's souls and stuffed it into my body, because I'm pretty sure the soul of a Scottish Terrier has set up shop in my right knocker.
And what is it that makes you think that?
Well, whenever the doorbell rings, my knocker goes crazy. It's like, pardon me, Sharon, it's like this.
Well, now, why didn't you just demonstrate on yourself?
I didn't want to wake him up.
Well, this is all very fascinating. Now, if you'll follow me, we'd like to do some light brain mapping.
All right, let's just make it quick, because I think someone's up now. Sit. Sit!
I'm Dr. Bethel, professor of theology at Yale, and this is Cardinal Hansen from the Council of Miraculous Phenomena.
As you can imagine, you are of great interest to both the secular and religious communities.
Yeah, we believe you've had a genuine encounter with the real Santa Claus.
This is nuts, man. I mean, we're just regular people who heard footsteps on Christmas Eve, and now we're a Christmas miracle.
Indeed. Now, tell us what happened after you awoke.
Well, me and my girl woke up and came downstairs, and Santa was standing there in our living room, real as rain.
And he says, "Come with me to the North Pole." And just like that, we were on his sleigh, like with the reindeer and everything.
Miraculous.
And you, Miss Rafferty?
Yeah, a little different for me. I'm crashing in their guest room, right? And I came downstairs a little later. They were gone. And I was met by a 9-foot-tall goat man named Crinkle Mouse, who, according to some German fairy tale, is Santa's helper. And he points a hoof at me and goes, and I kind of got the hint that I should come with.
And were you taken to Santa's sleigh?
Oh, no, 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 no. Crinkle Mouse, turns out, travels by dog sled, which sounds fun, but then he straps a harness on me, throws me in with the frickin' dog team, and these dogs don't fly, they run. And let me tell you, if you think you can't run as fast as a dog, you're right. A minute in, I fall. I get dragged for a mile over a rough forest floor, and my sweats get yanked off. So now there's nothing between the ground and my cooter and tooter. Look, wasn't the worst time I've had on all fours.
Fascinating. Now, what happened when you arrived at the North Pole?
Well, it sounds crazy, but we were taken to Santa's workshop. Man, it was beautiful, and it smelled just like gingerbread. And, my beard still smells like it, ma'am.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, and Mrs. Claus came out with mugs of hot cocoa. It warmed my tummy and my heart.
What? These two are in a Disney movie. Meanwhile, Crinkle Mouse takes me to the reindeer stables. He hands me a shovel. He goes, "You work!" And also, I had the pleasure of meeting the missus, that's Mrs. Crinkle Mouse, who looks more like a ram than a goat. And she's either jealous or a les, because she starts ramming my knocker like that. Pardon me, Sharon, she's going,
that's enough. They get it, I think. They get it.
Like that.
And what happened next in the workshop?
Well, you're not gonna believe me, but the elves came out and we all sang songs.
Yeah, there was a bunch of chubby little guys in fun pointy hats with these cute little toeses and noses.
Yeah, the stables have one elf. He looks exactly like Gollum. Smelled like a hard-boiled egg, and I swear to God, this little bastard's name was Shart.
Okay, well, did he also sing and dance?
No, he, He's in charge of the reindeer, right? And he tells me it's time to check them for worms. Cut to, I'm holding on to a lady reindeer. I'm keeping her steady while Shart's coming and poking around. And remember, these reindeer can fly, so when she bucks, I'm getting 20, 30 feet off the ground, and I'm still rocking zero pants here, so my hog taker and log maker are on full display. Let's just say I understand why Crinkle Mouse and company aren't showing up on any Coca-Cola Christmas cans.
I don't think you had as good a time as we did.
Oh, yeah, Doug? Yeah?
And how were you returned home?
Well, Santa sprinkled this magic dust, and the whole workshop just dissolved around us.
And then we were just back in our living room Christmas morning, and we went right out and loaded up the flatbed with Christmas ham for the poor, came home that night and made tender love for the first time in 6 years.
The Lord works in mysterious ways.
Yeah, so does Shart. Because when it was time for me to go, Crinkle Mouse hands him a magic stick, and this son of a bitch steps up to the plate and cracks me in the back of the knee with it. And I dissolve into a closed Bank of America 15 miles from my house. And I trip some sort of alarm, so the cops show up. And mind you, I am still pantsless, so now I'm spending Christmas morning in the back of a squad car with my grassy knoll and my gassy hole hanging out. And I'm thinking, damn it, Colleen, you're becoming your mother.
Wow, remarkable. Do you think you'll ever see these spirits again?
No, but I feel Saint Nick in my heart.
Yeah, I see him whenever I see a child smile.
Yeah, I smell hard-boiled eggs, so Shart can't be too far off. I think that little bastard followed me home. Oh, boy. Great. What the hell am I gonna feed that thing? Yeah.